Wish everybody a happy feast of the Apostles Peter and Paul. It started on June the 1st, June the 2nd was the beginning of the fast, and here we are today, July the 12th. So I wish you the blessings of St. Peter and St. Paul. May they be with you throughout the year. So I'd like to take a few minutes to talk about some of the inspirations we get from St. Peter and St. Paul to help us in our daily life. St. Paul says in his epistle to the Corinthians, he says we are God's fellow workers. He says we are all God's fellow workers. So God's fellow workers are not just the saints, the martyrs, the apostles, people that are up in heaven. God, out of his great love, considers every one of us, or invites every one of us, to be his fellow workers. There are people, though, who choose to not accept the invitation to work with God, to be his fellow workers. It's a big thing to give up on. You get someone like God calling you to work with him. Many people have refused to accept this invitation. Many have also accepted it, and this is what happens to them. They have churches named after them, and their names are written in heaven. That's what it says in today's gospel. That don't rejoice because the demons are subject to you in my name, but rejoice rather in this, that your names are written in heaven. So our names are written in heaven, but not everybody accepts the invitation. It's like I'm invited to a dinner or a reception. If I don't accept the invitation, my seat is reserved until the date. If I don't show up, my seat will be given to someone else. But I'm more than welcome to show up. And this is an important message because often we find ourselves divided into two major groups in a church, for example. The group that is very eager to serve, and they're overworked and tired because it's all on them. And then there's another group who feels like they're never asked to serve, or there's nothing for them to do. But actually, these two groups need each other tremendously. And there's a great need for everyone to serve in whatever capacity God has chosen for them. So, basically, in a nutshell, St. Peter and St. Paul were different in their lives, right? They didn't know each other from childhood. They had different occupations, but they chose the same choices. They made the same decisions. So that's what made them cross paths. They may have started in different walks of life, but that's the amazing thing about God, that he can use anyone in any way. St. Peter met Christ in his life, lived with him, right? Almost 3 years on earth. St. Peter also was married. St. Peter was a simple fisherman. St. Paul met Jesus after his ascension. So after Jesus departed, so St. Paul didn't have that 3 years of ministry preparation that the 12 disciples had. St. Paul wasn't married. St. Paul was a philosopher, a Pharisee. He was taught by a man named Gamaliel, who was supposed to be one of the most highly learned Pharisees and philosophers of the time. So again, two different lifestyles, two different education levels, two different occupations, but again, they made the same decisions. St. Peter preached to the Jews, he wrote two epistles, and he accepted the call of the Lord. So if anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me. St. Paul preached to the Gentiles, not the Jews. St. Paul wrote 14 epistles. If any, also accepted the same invitation. If anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, bear the cross, and follow me. So again, we see that at the end, their choices were the same. Well, they didn't start the same. They both followed Christ from the bottom of their hearts. St. Peter had to leave something, just as St. Paul had to leave something. St. Peter had to leave his fish, his gains, his ships, his family. And the Lord brought him that huge, abundant load of fish that they needed more ships to come because the nets were breaking. That was a huge business profit. St. Peter had a choice to just keep working as a fisherman or to follow Christ wholeheartedly. He just left it all for Christ. St. Paul left his distinguished position in society, being a Pharisee, his prestige. You know, he even says, I was a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. This meant that he was very high up there in his status in society. He had to give all that up as soon as he began to preach Christ. He was ostracized by the Jewish community, and he was threatened by death multiple times, as you read in his epistles in the book of Acts. So they both left different things. But again, this is just a pattern of what every person who chooses Christ on earth may need to do. You may not have to give up on fish or prestige, but there are certain things each one of us is called to give up, to bear our cross, to follow Christ. But again, the rewards compared to the sacrifice are incredible. The sacrifice is not to be compared. It's an insult to compare the sacrifice to the reward. Today's gospel says, after these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also, and sent them 2 by 2 before his face in every city and place where he himself was about to go. So the Lord was going there anyway. And this is the message for us now. So we have an idea of St. Peter and St. Paul. But the Lord is expecting from us the same kind of choices, to make the same kinds of decisions. We are called to be his fellow workers. He is going to go wherever anyway. It's not that he's waiting for me. But in a way he is, because he wants to give me that blessing of serving with him and getting the blessing of that service. It's not going to be easy. He never said it would be easy. But again, the rewards would be above and beyond. Then he said to them, the harvest truly is great, the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. So after saying that, the Lord said, pray that there be more laborers in the harvest. What makes it hard for there to be laborers? Why did Jesus say, pray that I could send more laborers into the harvest? Is it the Lord was being picky about whom he sends? Or is it the individual who is refusing the invitation to go ahead and serve? Like I said, the Lord will work with anyone. Anyone. The problem is not the Lord picking the problem. The problem is me not being willing to accept the call, the invitation. That's the main issue. And this is what St. Paul and the apostles teach us, that our hindrances in accepting the call. St. Paul said, what things were gained to me, these I have found and lost for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ. So St. Paul is basically telling us, all that prestige, all that stuff that I gave up is rubbish compared to what I gained in Christ. Rubbish. So imagine that we are hindering God's work in us, or we might be hindering God's work in us, because we're holding on to things that are, at the end of the day, not worthy to be compared to Christ himself. St. Paul also says in the Hebrews about Moses the prophet, by faith Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God and to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, and look to the reward. St. Moses the prophet preferred to give up his status. He could have been Pharaoh. He said, I'd rather give all that up to obey the call of God to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt, out of bondage for over 4 centuries. You're going to give up all that. You know how Egypt was at the time. Egypt was the dynasty, the empire. He says, it doesn't matter. This is temporary. It's passing. St. James says, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Could I make myself an enemy of God by by certain friendships I make in day-to-day society? Is it possible that I may be choosing things that make me an enemy of God? These are the things that hinder us from accepting the call. God can work with anyone and make something great out of them. This is just a list of names that I found. It's not all of the names, it's just a few examples, just to show us how God works with anyone and turns them into amazing things. First, you have Abraham. Abraham was too old. God worked with him. Jacob blind. God worked with him. Joseph was abused by his brothers. God worked with him. Moses had a stuttering issue. And he didn't want to obey God's call. God used him. Gideon was afraid to accept the call. God worked with his fear because he trusted in God. Rahab was a prostitute. God used marriages actually in the lineage of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jeremiah was too young. He even said, I'm too young for this. Timothy also said, I'm too young. In the sense that he was instructed by St. Paul as a very young bishop what to do as a bishop. David committed adultery once, and he murdered the man that the woman was married to. But God still worked with him. And we read his Psalms today, and they're in our Bibles. Jonah ran away from God. Naomi was a widow, helpless. Peter denied Christ. Paul was a blasphemer, persecuted. The disciples fell asleep while praying. Martha worried about everything. Zacchaeus was too short. That's why he climbed the sycamore tree. And the last one is my favorite. This is my favorite one. Lazarus is dead. He still worked with him. God was able to use a dead man to accomplish his goals, his will. Lazarus was 4 days in the tomb. There is no one God can't work with. So if anyone still thinks that I'm not worthy or I can't, or I'll leave it to somebody else who's more competent, you are not doing God justice. This is actually an insult to God. Do you realize that? I don't know if you realize that or not. You may not think it that way. You may not mean it that way intentionally. But it's actually insulting to God. When I tell him, no, you know, I do something, no, I'm not good enough. It's right. Basically, I'm limiting his power, his capacity. What he can do. There's nothing that he cannot do except fail. He can't fail. That's pretty much it. So when I say no, I can't, or I shouldn't, or I don't know how, or I should say, Lord, I like St. Paul said, I'd rather boast in my infirmities or my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Let me say I don't know how. God, you know how, use me. Rather than wait year after year, decade after decade, or, okay, when I'm ready, when I'm older, when I have time, when I have money, when I have, when, and then tomorrow never comes. Let's not delay it further. St. Francis of Assisi said, I was unholy in all things. He said, I was bad in everything. I was a sinner in everything, yet if God can work through me, he can work through anyone. St. Francis of Assisi, if God can work through me, he can work through anyone. Promises in Isaiah chapter 41. God says, have no fear, for I'm with you. I will be with your strength. I will help you. I will hold you with my right hand. Don't be afraid. I will hold you up. Don't be afraid to try. And St. Peter answered, and Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth I perceive that God shows no partiality. God doesn't have favorites. Let me repeat that for those who aren't paying attention. God has no favorites. And there's still people that are not focused on the whisper. God has no favorites. Everybody hear that? So don't think that God prefers some people over others. Don't think that God is preferential to a certain group of people than others. That's not true. God shows zero partiality. He loves everyone. And every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness, is accepted by him. If you fear God and you try to do well, you're already on the path of acceptance. You're already halfway there. Now I leave you with this quote, which is very powerful, means a lot. Can you go back? Sorry, I didn't pass. Thanks. Don't let the devil put a question mark where God has already put a period. Everybody understands that? Don't let the devil put a question mark where God has already put a period. God says, I don't show partiality. Period. The devil tries to put a question mark. Are you sure God doesn't show partiality? Just like he did with Eve thousands of years ago. Did God say you shouldn't eat of every tree? God puts a period, the devil puts a question mark. Stop allowing the devil to put question marks in your mind. And you yourself don't participate with him by adding the question marks. A period is a period. And God's promises